Hi, this is LTJ Bukem, and you're here in my studio.
And this is how it all began.
My first interest in music was playing the piano.
It started classical training from about the age of 5 till like 11, 12.
By the age of 15, 16, I kind of got into buying music as well. And I was playing the music out at friends' parties. So kind of the DJing was born then.
When I was 9, moved to Aylesbury and sort of hooked up with the guys that were doing sort of breakdancing around town. PhD Paddy was one of the guys. Some of the guys got into DJing. When they were DJing, the mic was there, and I'd sort of like start human beatboxing. And then that sort of expanded onto rapping.
I found Summer, MC Conrad, like, on the stage. I'm going to ask him what he thinks of the night.
It'd be all right if you didn't hear, like, some kind of mad wailing from the main stage, but other than that, it's all right.
I'm Blame from Good Looking Records and 720 Degrees, and you're in my studio.
The reason I've been called Blame is kind of the name stuck with me since early kind of school days. Just, I don't know, whenever there's any like trouble and that, I was always like, the finger was always pointed at me, sort of thing. It's a nickname that kind of stuck.
The first track I produced on my own was a track called Music Takes You, which I made in 1990. Since then, that had to be kind of a sort of seminal point in what I was doing. It made me realise the power within music. So when I finally got a chance to go into a studio, it was a natural step for me to think, I want to kind of, the hip-hop element, the breakbeats in there, but I want the London kind of uniqueness on there. All these elements fused together to form drum and bass.
Okay.
Here it comes.
It's got to be a goal.
I just used that goal.
Don't you celebrate anymore, Blake.
Don't need to, mate.
I never actually owned my own pair of decks until sort of 87, when I kind of first went out to see a big warehouse rave.
You know, I went out to a few raves, checked it out, and I sort of like found myself into sort of like a small percentage of it, but I sort of found the sort of like atmosphere a good vibe to be involved in.
I couldn't really get into the whole acid sort of music. I first got interested in music in like the electro era.
It took me ages to get into like dance music scene and going out raving and stuff, because I was just staying in. I was like, nah, man, I've got to stay in and listen to my hip-hop. It's like the Bible and stuff.
And I'm like, hold on a minute. 10,000 people here. A system bigger and fatter than I've ever seen in my whole life. People mixing up this... What's this music they're mixing up? It's like acid, house, electronic music I've never even heard before in my life. And I'm like, that's it. This is what I've got to be into, do you know what I mean?
So I was like, I'm going to go and buy a pair of decks.
And went to my girlfriend's house at the time there, bought the decks, sat up there and just started mixing music. Get up at like 10, 11 in the morning and go to bed about 3, 4 in the morning, and all I've done all day is mix music. That was it. There was nothing else to my life.
So I was playing everywhere for like 20, 30 quid and train fares and bus fares.
And for the next sort of 2 years, sent out tapes for DJ promoters from everywhere and all over the place. Whoever I could get a tape to that promoted anything vaguely like a rave, they'd get a tape from me.
I'm watching you. So I asked a friend of mine, Gerald, do you want to start a rap group? Got a few rhymes together, got a name, Triple Element. So we got this track together called What's That Sound? In the middle of recording What's That Sound, it was like split opinions on what should be done. You know, it came down to a real stupid argument. I remember somebody speaking to me on the phone saying, if you're not down in London with this contract signed within an hour, then you're off the track. So from that point, I ceased to be in Triple Element.
My name is DJ Taylor. Basically, I started DJing when I was 18 years old, starting to mix up house music, and met a guy called LTJ Bukem, who DJed in Watford. Become friends, and he kind of encouraged me to get my DJing onto a tape, and I got some work in Ibiza, and that's where I'm pretty much where my DJing career started.
In 1990, I got a phone call back from Ray Spence. That was a guy that ran Rain Dance in Jenkins Lane. They just phoned up and said, why don't you come along and do a set? Come the night now, I'm absolutely wetting myself. First time in front of like 10,000 people, I'm like, I can't do this. And it took my friend Longers and Chalky and Cutters Right actually to get their hand under my arse and push me up this ladder to where the decks were. And literally they were doing it because I was like, motionless.
I remember mixing an old 90s kind of drum and bass track by some artist called 2 Kilos into like an a cappella of Frankie Knuckles' Tears.
Everyone went mad, do you know what I mean? The whole place went fucking ballistic. And that just gave me a boost. I was immediately transfixed out of my, like, shakiness into, like, all right, let's go. It was like the beginning of a chapter for the old TJ Bukem, if you like.
The other MCs I was listening to just seemed to be sort of like giving it a hardcore, you know the score, you know, a lot of shouting. And I just thought, well, I can do better than that. A friend of mine from High Wycombe had started putting on raves in High Wycombe, invited me down to be a resident MC.
Started MCing about 1989. It was like hip-hop stuff. Then I was about 90, 91, 92. I got convinced to go to Quest. I had Conrad there for the first time. I was like, ah, this is what I want to do.
Well, I met Conrad back in 1990 at a rave on a farmyard somewhere in Slough.
The guy that I'd met at Telepathy was DJing there, DJ Trace. And he said, listen, you've got an MC for me, and also you've got to meet this other guy, a friend of mine, Bukem. He's a real badass DJ, and like, I think you two will link up well. Bukem turned up for the last set in the morning. I didn't know none of his tunes of what he was going to play. He didn't know what I was going to do. I just sort of introduced myself to the crowd and said, right, you've never heard this before. Something totally different. Check it out. And did sort of like a little bit of scratching before Bukem started. And then somehow he sort of like dropped the tune in right on the mark. And a lot of people that were watching that time were like, never seen this before. You two have got to link together. That was just like crazy.
Early 1990, I made Demon's Theme, and Demon's Theme was to be the start of Good Looking Records in 1991. Those times there, those sort of 1990 to 94, they made me realise how hand in hand a DJ, record label owner, producer, tied together, do you know what I mean?
My name's Olive Lomax and I record under the name of Artemis and Good Looking Records. LTJ Bukem picked up on a couple of my dats and he loved what I was doing so much that I got signed to label and it's just gone from there really.
My famous motto is play it to me, I'll tell you if I like it.
I like started making tunes, so I like made my first tune, Above and Beyond. Conrad gave it Dan and Dan loved it.
Also, what I play out, I put out.
Hi, we're Blue Marten. My name's Chris. This is my partner, Leo. We signed to LTJ Bukem's Good Looking Records. I'd heard on a Kiss show, Bukem giving out his PO box for new stuff. You know, we whacked together a track. We just banged it in the post and sent it off to him. And about 2 days later, I got a manic phone call from Leo saying, oh, Bukem's left a message on my answer machine. And he signed us to the label. And we were so pleased, we even datted the answer phone message.
First of all, Good Looking Records was like my tracks, the first 5 tracks. And people would give me tracks on that and go cutting dub plates. I'm like, well,
I love it. So I'll play it, so why don't I put it out?
I guess you really don't know me then, do you?
Hi, I'm Seba. I'm called for Good Looking Records, and we're in Montreux at Montreux Jazz. Got involved with Good Looking Records when Danny was playing in Sweden, the Lollipop Festival, and I gave him a DAT with a track that I made, and he liked it, so he phoned me up and said, yeah, let's put it out.
Then 94 came, Sarah, Fabio and myself and Leo and Conrad decided to start Speed.
It was like a small jazz club, an intimate jazz club, with drum and bass mixed with jazz being played. We were like, this is the ultimate hip-hop, house, jazz, funk influences in one kind of music.
Speed was kind of the platform that elevated a lot of people and elevated this music.
Then we thought it was a time to do a compilation album, because we get big gains sort of 4 or 5 years. Let's reflect on what's been and gone. So that was kind of the birth of Logical Progression.
Then in 1995, we kind of ran into a lot of tax problems.
I don't know, you're so into the music and the DJing, and you're so, you don't even, do you know what I mean? I wasn't even thinking about tax or VAT or any kind of things. And
at the same time, I met up with Tony Fordham.
Tony actually came to help us do the party for the album. There was like 120 odd grand out to like the VAT man, and people were knocking on my door, and people were telling me my studio's gonna get taken away, and this, that, and the other. And I was like, I was ready to like give it up. Tony back off the break.
Yeah, this is LTJ Bukem and MC Conrad reporting for Hey Good Looking live in the, I don't know, where are we, Conrad?
Don't know.
It's a new beginning. The horizon leans forward, offering you space to place new steps of change.
Around 94, when I made Horizons, but the vocal sample that that I used in the track kind of, for me, summed up what was going on at the time and what kind of needed to happen, which is like kind of the horizon leans forward, offering new steps for change. The first night then, in fact, like 10,000, was very nerve-wracking. But ever since then, I'm kind of like the same. I'm totally nervous. Every time I go and play a set of music, I think that's, I don't know, I think it like keeps me on the ball. It's that kind of nervous excitement. It's like, yeah, you can't wait to be playing your music out on a system to people and sharing that vibe that you feel with someone else, and that can like send bolts of lightning through you. Now you're locked into this mystic vibe. A good gig for me definitely was Roskilde in Denmark. Oof. And there's no feeling like 8 or 10,000 people totally getting into what you're doing and totally connecting with your vibe. Certainly my idea of DJing is to try and take people on a journey, start somewhere, tell them a story about a certain sound. And when I play a set of music out, I'm actually taking myself on a journey. So I'm totally locked into what I'm doing, and that's taking me somewhere. So if you can take someone else somewhere, then mission accomplished. I'm always kind of like searching for this perfect set that starts with the perfect mood, with the perfect tempo, and moves up through the gears and ends on like a high kind of thing. And it's still got to have certain sounds, and it's got to be mixed a certain way. I haven't found it yet. And I can be easily sort of, yeah, easily pissed off about what I do. Never yet been happy with a tune that I've ever made. In the early days of like Demons and Music and Horizons, I mean, a lot of them were like half-finished tunes to me, which is something I don't know if I should be saying, but there you go, I said it. I think music in general is such a personal thing to each and every individual. drum and bass isn't a massively popular music yet. It's, I don't know, in a certain way, it's like jazz, isn't it? It's like free-form music. Certain people will be, like, into it, and certain people won't. It's a personal thing.
People do all sorts of things to this music, and I think that is the beauty of it. It opens so many different thought patterns in your head, has different ways of taking people, and I think when people realise that, that is what kind of hooks them to it. In time and space, 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 you're climbing at your own pace. The relationship I have with a DJ is trying to maintain the vibe that they're playing and lock into that and just become one with the music as the DJ tries to make a seamless performance on the turntables. I'm trying to sort of weave within that vocally so that it's not just an MC and it's sort of like I'm up there performing or, you know, I'm back there behind the DJ. It's the two things moving together. Create one performance that you hear in words and music.
As we move on,
the biggest buzz I get from being MC Conrad is the fact that I get up in the morning and I'm not doing something else to try and be an MC. I've actually achieved a goal in being an MC and trying to maintain that. That's something that sort of turns me on every day.
Conrad's definitely on point tonight. The geezer's bad. He's always hyping up the crowd, getting things going. He's a valuable part of what we're doing within the progression sessions unit. Even though every now and again he doesn't do fuck all.
I wake up and all I can think is like music, and like can't get to sleep because I'm thinking about music. My like sole aim is to like better myself musically.
I think drum and bass has evolved the way it has because a lot of guys have the same kind of vision around the same kind of time within music, like trying to get breakbeats, speeding up breakbeats, laying over kind of sounds gathered from a vast kind of array of styles from house to kind of hip-hop to orchestral kind of sounds, and they've all kind of layered together and just kind of developed their own style. Fuels me and my music is everything I do. I want to break some boundaries. I want to try and like do something different. That's part of the Blame trademark, is to kind of step on ground that hasn't been stepped on before. I feel drum and bass is the most progressive music that you can express yourself with. So if you're going to want to experiment and expand, this is the sound that you're going to do it with.
Starts fresh. To elevate your thoughts is
like the live thing, it's where it all came from, you know. Before you MCs were paired off with DJs and you probably didn't, you know, never met the DJ before, but now you're making a bond with him, do you know what I mean?
Let the music enhance and go your nervous system. Arms start twitching, suddenly you're twisting.
The way I work with DRS and Conrad in a set is kind of working up the crowd, taking them down low, bringing them back up, kind of moving around and stuff, so you kind of bounce off each other.
With the deep and meaningful musical spiritual, can you hear it? All streets cascade over mine like a waterfall.
The music's got a lot tighter and the production is certainly a lot better, and I think people have explored new ways sort of technically and musically by involving the live edge of it.
Intense came to be virtually from school. Both Simon and I went through that whole proper recording engineering schooling. One day the Thompson Twins came up, asked us to do a garage mix of one of their tunes, and it went to number 7 in the American dance charts. It gave us a name in dance music. And a friend of ours that had been popping over to the studio called Bo started butting in on the production and saying, hey guys, why don't you put this in? Or we were like, hey, shut up, you know, you can't do that, you can't do that. And we thought, after a while, all his ideas are really good. Why don't we get him in as third member of Intense? We all decided to try and use real instruments, i.e. my father.
I am Molly, saxophone player with Intense, also happens to be Dan's father, and a good mate of all the guys since they were at school.
Obviously, with his history being in the ˈbʊkəm band as a funk and soul jazz sax player, it had a lot of influence that rubbed off on me, but I can't play sax to save my life.
Mr. Molly Ducker!
As a musician, I obviously have a biased opinion, but I respect him, and Tim Canfield, our guitarist, and Killian Madden, our drummer, are all phenomenal musicians in their own right. And for us to be playing with them, but under our name, it's the biggest honor you can ever have.
Where is Goat Buggerer? My God, we've reached the Golden Fleece! Look! Look, it's the Golden Fleece! Gentlemen, we have arrived. Our quest is over.
It's got to be Intense. You got me? For the record, man.
For the record.
1600, yeah? 1600. Oi, Intense.
I'll tell you what, Molly and Tim, you are lucky you just come here, play your music and then get paid and fuck off. I'll tell you, you boys, don't know how lucky you are. Yeah. Don't they? They
get paid.
Our artists basically expressing themselves in any way they feel, which I think is something which is essential for all record labels. You have to be able to express yourself and make the music you feel you want to make and have a label there supporting you. I think there's something you can find in every style of music that can influence you and better what you're about and what you're going to do. Drifting on a melody, reminiscently, future music and a red MC. Progressing to take you into the fourth chapter. Logic was the essence and the vibe we capture. The music was the madness that made the mind meditate. The moments of music make the body move. I will prove it. In for the ways, the juice we pray to progress and sets to Conrad and LTJ.
Danny sort of like had this way of picking out the right parts of the tune and mixing them in the right sort of way that still gave it that lush feeling but also that rough edge that the breakbeat had now bought.
I mean, LTJ Bukem through his own DJing and music like shaped my own sound, sort of the way is like the way he did his music sort of had a lot of influence over my drum and bass sound. Not that I copy him, but he sort of he played a big part in the way I made my music.
One of the most interesting things about the music that people like us write is that it's not like traditional music in that it can't be notated. For example, some of the stuff we're writing now, you couldn't take it away and play an acoustic set. You couldn't reduce it to its barest elements on an acoustic guitar. It's a completely modern way of writing. Drum and bass, really, even if the stuff that comes from other countries, to me, it'll always be the soundtrack for London.
When you walk around London, if you've got drum and bass in your headphones, it all seems to fit. And Chris went to New York a couple of years ago, and I've been there and done exactly the same thing, which is to walk around New York and listen to hip-hop, and that fits. And it seems to be the soundtrack for the place you live in.
I enjoy what I do, and I like to think I'm bringing enjoyment to some people.
I love all things that are space. There's something like some serious nostalgia with science fiction films and everything, which I think you can kind of relate to when you listen to my music. Whenever I work on a track, it's always as a concept. I can kind of see an image, kind of see a kind of storyboard in my head on how I want that track to go.
The first time I heard this, I was like, oh my God, this is what the future is. It's like you could feed the information that's inside of this construct of music and generate cityscapes, universes, heroes, villains. It's all encapsulated and encrypted inside of the structure of the sound. It's an entirety. It is a complete structure.
I'm working on a track at the moment. I'm kind of coordinating with a visual element as well, and we're trying to build both of the kind of sides up together to form a unit, if you like, to create a video but that's kind of crafted with the music. So there's a kind of story going on, the kind of correlation between music and space.
Video was an attempt to basically show what human beings are and what could be if human beings stretch themselves as far as they can possibly go, and just kind of exemplifying that through graphics.
In the same way as the music, I think the video is going to be exploring uncharted territory.
In the 1990s, the reason a lot of people are turning to music like drum and bass, it's kind of like the 21st century. I think people change underground because people want to get back to that old vibe, do you know what I mean? Music made for music's sake, not for money. It's like music made for music's sake will always ring much truer than music made for money's sake.
Because it's the real. It's music with intelligence. It's about as intelligent as this fucking light that's like piercing through the back of my head.
Grown and has grown stronger day by day, step by step.
Sheer togetherness and unity and the whole kind of setup that we've got a good look in, and the whole way in which we treat the music as a unit is also as much a driving force as the music itself. I couldn't just sort of do this on my own. It'd be a lonely life, I think.
You're watching Hey Good Looking. Keep it locked, we'll be back.
This is Cornelius Bagraves, San Francisco Virgin Airlines, reporting for Good Looking TV. Bye!
I think if we take it from like 1990 to like when Good Looking started, or whatever, 91 to now, it's just been a slow progression, a gradual kind of expanding the company and the music and the people that we've been reaching. I remember when I was sort of sending out DJ tapes and things, the amount of people that didn't actually get back to you or didn't actually even acknowledge the fact that they've got something from you, which is something I always wanted to be able to do. Every single tape or CD that comes into the office, for no matter what category or style of music, I wanted to be an answer to. And I always like listen to everything myself, write notes on it, give it back to them guys, they type a letter, send it back to them. That's important to me. That will always be the same. I'm totally responsible for the A&R of Good Looking. I have to listen to everything, because I do think I'll miss something, and that could be a big tune or whatever.
Look, you see? Good Looking walk around in no clothes.
What's a couple of months ago, we released our first artist album, and that was Big Bud, which is quite an achievement for us and something that kind of held special inside of me, because we've always done like compilations up until then, and to actually start putting out artist albums is, yeah, taking it to another level.
Let's make a tune. That's a turn on.
It's a sample, wait. We might sample it in the video.
I'm currently working on an album project, Logical Progression 4, hopefully coming out sometime in the year 2000. Within that, I'm going to be presenting a live package with a band, working with a band as a production team. And, you know, that will show off some of my ideas that I've had about this music from way, way back. Some of the sounds that I was hearing, how live instrumentation can manipulate the whole structure of drum and bass and sort of integrate within that. And hopefully some of my vocal skills will shine through that I'm meant to have. So that's me for the moment.
Blame is hopefully going to be doing his artist album this year.
I think 720 is predominantly a futuristic kind of label, you know. The music of 720 Degrees is inspired by science fiction films and, you know, mad things that are happening in the world today that drum and bass wasn't, like, picking up on. And it was just my chance, really, to kind of get that out as a unit and create a kind of a sound. I've just mixed a double album for 720, which is called Two Revolutions. It's basically the future past, if you like, and the future present of where I see drum and bass is at. You've got one of the mixed albums has got the back catalogue that I've built up over the last 2 years of the 720 tracks that were released. The kind of future CD is all brand new music. You've got all the kind of releases lined up, all the 720 singles ready to go, some brand new artists in the pipeline that I'm developing, that we're building up. So there's a lot of interesting stuff happening.
Nah, oh, sorry mate, nah. You're talking, I'm talking pure bullock buffalo system. Running.
We're actually dedicating a label and a set of artists and a night to doing downtempo music and different forms of music.
Now we've started cooking, which is like taking a whole new, brought a whole new division of people into the sound and the camp, really. You know, people are kind of, this is the sound that Dan likes as well as drum and bass, so it's like, whoa. Now, instead of just drum and bass people kind of buying the records, hopefully it's going to span out and we're going to have, like, you know, a whole new section of people.
You get everything soul, drum and bass, everything. It's all just good music, basically. So if you like good music, come down here to cooking.
I'd like to even do a house label at some stage. So we're actually catering for, like, all forms of dance. And we can then sign any artist and no track gets wasted. I mean, all the artists that sign to the label, they're signed because I like their style of music. So there's no point in just saying, well, I signed you to make drum and bass, so that's what you're gonna make. When obviously in their head they're thinking, well, I'd like to make a down-tempo tune, a soul track, a house track. Go and make it. I want to be able to put it out, because I know I'm going to like it.
Oh! Daniel, did you like a cable in there? You did, didn't you?
I sure did, yeah.
Fantastic.
Shit. It's just shit.
As a person, over the last 7-8 years, no, I don't think I've changed one iota. I think Conrad can vouch for that and most people around me. I'm still the same mad, passionate music lover that I always was and always will be.
It's gone blonde.
Friday, we was in Cardiff doing progression sessions. And from there, we jumped over the ocean over to the States. We'd sort of been in three different locations, Atlanta, Palm Springs.
We're in Palm Springs at the moment.
San Fran with no sleep. Yeah, time zones and what have you. Now we're back in England in Bournemouth.
Wait till the light to go green.
It's very tiring. Haven't really slept for three, four days now. It's all kind of too much really, but it's good fun. When you see the end result, it's all worth it. It makes it worthwhile when the people are out there having it.
It's good over in the States, in a sense that they're into what we do. You know, any type of music from outside of Saxe has difficulty breaking through over there. So to get a reception like we're getting over there is really good, although there's still a lot of work to be done.
Tony Fordham has lost his ticket.
This seems to be a scenario that we're all quite used to.
And he's now going through tickets at about 4 years old.
I understood it was all part of the plan, so something about you not wanting Mr. Fordham to travel?
We can look at that as something they call fate.
He's a buffoon. So is he.
You know, I hate looking into the future and saying what it's going to do. I just hope it does a lot of things that we can look back on and say, yeah, that was like a serious thing to be doing.
For us, it's about developing the sound, it's about bettering the sound. You know, it's not about saying, yeah, this is our thing, we're keeping it. It's about spreading the word and it's about creating better music, full stop. The thing that I've started, so I finish. The thing that's built drum and bass is the kind of vision that people have had within it, and you can't stop that now. That's always got to develop. I'm currently working on an EP to be coming out, which is then going to be building up to a solo album. You know, that's going to be my kind of achievement in life, really, I think. Once the album's complete, I'll be happy.